Hello, everybody, and welcome to this panel organized by the American Journal of Public Health about building bridges to improve health. And just a couple of words about why the journal organizes that. For the last few years, every April issue dedicated to the National Public Health Week has had a section about the public health dialogue. That is, people with very different political perspectives, you know, Democrats, Republicans, libertarians, have been talking together, discussing, having points and counterpoints, exchanging about major issues in public health. And I have to say that this has been extremely interesting. I've learned a lot from that. And the original idea, I have to thank him, came from David Sunwell, who is a public health person, a health commissioner in Utah for a long time. He's had a long time in politics with Republicans, but he broke the ice and he came to a session that AJPH was organizing in 2016 about the election. And that was fantastic. I mean, we've learned so much by exchanging our ideas, and we became convinced at the journal that I mean, people have different values, you know, they have different views of the world, and this you cannot change. But we can have a common ground and talk about evidence and talk about history and see what's useful for public health. And that's the objective of this journal, is to bring together everybody in public health that is ready to talk on the basis of evidence, as far as evidence can be available, and to try to find what's best for the health of the population. So that's why we're having this public health dialogue. And my guests today are public health persons that have contributed to this April issue of the journal. You see the April issue behind me. And so let me tell you who is there. And I'm going to start from my left, at least. Howard Rodenberg is a physician. He's currently practicing in Florida, but for many years he's been health commissioner in the state of Kansas, and he has a long experience in public health from those perspectives. Julie Gerberding. Julie Gerberding is a physician. She's been a director of CDC for about 8 years under the George W. Bush administration. And she's currently a physician at the pharmaceutical firm Merck. And finally, I have Dr. Ferdinand, Keith Ferdinand. He's a cardiologist. He's a working physician in Louisiana, in New Orleans, at Tulane University. And I believe, I haven't asked them, but so I just speculate that my three guests are representative of three different current political current in some way, or I have sensitivity. You know, they are related to three different currents in U.S. politics. I don't know, so I'm just guessing. But so let's get into the discussion right now with a question I have for all of you. And just chime in as you wish. What is public health for you? You know, what does public health represent for you? What attracts you to it, and why have you been involved into it? So who wants to start?
I'll start. As you say, I'm a practicing cardiologist and a professor of medicine, but I'm also a person who's very interested in community health and public health. I was the national director for the National Heart and Lung Blood Institute's physician outreach program. And for many years, we tried to make sure that guidelines and things that we developed related to hypertension didn't just sit in a magazine in a dusty bin, but were applied across all populations. So for me, public health takes the one-to-one physician, clinician, patient relationship, but make sure that it's something that involves everyone, that we as a family of humans can benefit from developments that we have in the environment, science, therapeutics, lifestyle.
Thank you, Keith.
I'll jump in. Yes. I think public health is complicated, and if you ask anybody in our profession the question, you'll probably get a different answer. But I think it's really, in a sense, it's the art and the science of creating both the context as well as the tools and the knowledge necessary to support people achieving their optimum state of health and well-being. That sounds kind of jargony, but I think it is both a process as well as a content issue, and it's a right. And I think it's something that in the aperture of a pandemic, we've really begun to appreciate exactly how important that right really is.
Thank you, Julie. Howard.
I think for me, public health is similar to what Keith said. It's a way to take that role as a physician and kind of have it writ large. So we're not just dealing with one patient at a time, but we're dealing with a population and trying to improve that population's health. And sometimes we do it through direct care, and sometimes we do it through regulation, and sometimes we do it through funding. But in any case, it's still that same goal of patient wellness, patient care, just writ on a much larger scale.
Thank you, Howard. And so this year, APHA has decided to choose as a theme for National Public Health Week this idea of building bridges. And I would really like to know what this means for you, building bridges. How do you see that? I find it very exciting. I love this this theme, but I'd like to know how you view it and what it means for you.
You know, when I saw that tagline, it made me feel optimistic. Because right now it's very hard to find reasons to be optimistic. We're dealing with an unprecedented pandemic, but also with the hard evidence of incredible systemic social injustices and a whole number of other highly partisan political processes in play. So to think about building bridges in this context and to experience the public health ecosystem sort of putting that challenge out there, it gave me hope, but it's also very aspirational, and I think it's something that we really should try to build from.
Great.
You know, Julia, I feel optimistic that things are going to get better, but not right now. Things are pretty bad. The vaccines have been a wonderful development in terms of preventing people from hospitalization and death. The uptake in the vaccines has been greatly increased, up to 3 million, 4 million on Saturday of the last weekend. But we still have a lot of barriers to vaccine uptake. And I share the concern that some of the public health and epidemiologist officials have that with the loosening of our mitigation efforts, wearing the mask, staying away from congregate settings, and the increase in the variants, specifically the B.1.1.7, that maybe the vaccines won't win, at least not in the short term. And I suspect that we are going to have some problems. One piece of data that I look to is from Manaus, Brazil, which is a town of 2 million in the Amazon. And they had the natural herd immunity experiment in the spring of 2020, April and May. This was the place where you saw the pictures in the lay media of the mass graves with the bulldozer just pushing bodies into an open ditch. And over 70% of people may have been affected. So it proved to them that you could just let this thing pass off, a lot of death and disability, but we'll be okay. Well, it didn't work out. Fast forward to January, February of 2021, 100 people dying, 3,000 people in the hospital. They're back to square one. It could be that natural immunity just won't work. And it also could be that the variants in Brazil, they have P1, can overcome any benefits of natural immunity. So I think unless we do the right thing, vaccines are clearly important. That's the only way we're going to get out of this doggone pandemic. But unless we do the right thing, the virus, either through variants or just through the natural waning of any infection that people may have had in earlier 2020, is going to come and come hard.
If I were going to put a title on what you just said, I would say, you know, it's vaccine and variants against, I mean, virus and variants against vaccine and vigilance. And right now it's neck and neck. And, you know, we are rooting for the vaccine, but if we don't keep the vigilance as high as necessary, we could still lose this race, at least for the foreseeable future. So we're very well put. We have no room for celebration, but we should be hopeful that in the long run, we will be able to take advantage of the science and the countermeasures that are in the pipeline or are already out there. Unfortunately, easy for us to say that in the US and a few other developed countries where we have access to these products, the whole world has a long way to go.
That's right. That's right. But so in this case, how can we, what should we do? What are the priorities for us to win this battle and to make sure that the vaccine is taken, is accepted, that, that people don't hesitate because it's such a crucial battle that we're waging?
Well, I'm working with Community Engagement Alliance, which comes out of NIH, in which we look specifically at certain racial or ethnic populations and try to overcome vaccine hesitancy. And actually, we're doing a doggone good job. If you look back in the early part of 2021, specifically in African Americans, only about 30% say they would take it. Now it's over 50%. So we've seen a marked improvement in some of the racial ethnic minority communities. And I think the way we've done it is through trusted messengers. Hopefully I'm one. They're not just doctors though. It's also ministers, religious leaders, community activists who look at the data, look at the outcome from the phase 3 trials of the 3 available vaccines, look at the 100 million people who've gotten the first dose, and we really don't see any significant disabling disabilities that come from the vaccination itself, and say to our people, because I'm a neighborhood guy, I'm from New Orleans, I was raised here, say to our people, look, the only way we're going to get out of this is with the vaccine. It will save lives, it'll keep you out of the hospital, it'll protect your grandmothers, your uncles, the older people, people with diabetes, heart disease, chronic kidney disease. We need to do it. And the Black community is changing. It's now actually improving remarkably in vaccine uptake.
That's very interesting. And, you know, when you wrote your piece, Keith, last winter, and telling me about the problems of hesitancy in the African-American community in Louisiana, I had the same, you know, piece of, you know, editorial sent from by Howard to me, and he was in Montana and the Dakotas, and it had to do with hesitancy among the white farmer population there. So, Howard, tell us, how did the situation evolve? Did it evolve as it did in Louisiana, or?
Well, I think the experience probably, if I just look at that population in general, is probably different than the population that Dr. Ferdinand's mentioned. I mean, the African-American population has pretty good reason to have vaccine hesitancy, especially when things are promulgated by the government that has obviously paid them short shrift in the past. In Montana, it was a little bit different. And in Kansas, where I'm from, it's a little bit different. That's more that streak of populism. That's more that streak of don't tell me what to do. And it's not that these people are, it's not that they're totally unreachable. But my concern is that a lot of the messages that have been promulgated don't touch on their concerns. Dr. Ferdinand just illustrated how a focused program that identifies the concerns of a specific population increases vaccine uptake, which is cool. That's what we need to do across the board. And one of my concerns has been, and one of the things that I wrote in my piece, is I don't think public health has done a very good job of understanding that people have other concerns other than transmissibility, other than mutation, other than vaccines, other than the things that occupy us as a group. And if we're going to try to get around that vaccine hesitancy issue, as well as the issue about whether we want to wear masks and whether we want to social isolate, everything else that goes along with it, we're going to have to understand the feelings and the currency that those folks talk in the same way Dr. Ferdinand and his group understands the currency and the language of the population he's working with.
But tell us, Howard, explain to us, what are those feelings and how do we respond to them?
Well, I think there's a number of different things that get mixed up in there. Certainly, some populations have a streak of populism, anti-authoritarianism, whatever word you want to use. Basically, they're big adolescents, just like all of us were when we were 15, 16, and our parents can't tell us what to do. So don't tell us what to do. So there's a large piece of that. there's a piece of it, especially in rural areas, of geography. You know, when you can't see COVID in front of you, you can't see the damage it's doing or it's doing it to the cities, which is the other, if you will, it doesn't become a concern for you. A lot of folks in rural areas are really working on thin budgets. And when people, or they're involved in transportation or agriculture, and when things come along that might restrict what you can do, what you can export, who you can interact with, that's a huge issue. And I think we might agree that social cohesion in rural areas operates by different rules than social cohesion in urban areas. I think the role of the church is bigger, the role of the community center, of the high school is bigger. And when you take away things like high school sports, it makes more of an impact in those rural areas. And so, again, I'm not endorsing the viewpoint that we shouldn't social isolate, we shouldn't wear masks, we shouldn't get vaccines. I'm absolutely in favor of all those. But I think if we want to avoid this vaccine hesitancy that you've mentioned, you need to try and address those concerns as you talk to folks rather than just list off the science and expect them to listen, because emotionally their heart is someplace else.
You know, I'm from South Dakota and I can completely relate to everything you just said. And we're proud of it. You know, we're proud of that independence. And as I always say, when we have a blizzard, we don't call FEMA, we right. handle it ourselves. So there is that that streak of taking matters into our own hands. But I also think that the sobering reality when it does hit a community, as it did my hometown of 800 people, when in a matter of a few weeks, the 100% attack rate in the little nursing home, it changes everything. And then you have ambassadors who understand firsthand the sense of loss, and they become part of the front line of helping people understand what they need to do. And the other thing I would just say, because of course, in the world of vaccines, we deal with this in every vaccine situation, not just COVID, that there is intentional disinformation that's put out there in the media where people can snatch it. And then, of course, there's just misinformation, misunderstanding or misinterpretation. And we all in the public health ecosystem can, if we see something, we should say something. When we see something that's not right, or when something is clearly either mis or disinformed, we should respond. We shouldn't just look at it and shake our heads or move on, because there are a lot more of us than there are of the people who are promulgating that kind of challenging information resource. So we can have our voices heard too, if we just, you know, collectively act in that direction.
Yeah, absolutely. Dr. Durbin, I think a public health official has to be an activist for the truth. And to the extent that there may be a certain political flavor or cultural flavor, I'm not from South Dakota, but if there's a certain situation there, you have to be empathetic, you have to have understanding, but you still have to speak the truth. I challenged one of the medical directors of a large IT corporation, whom you know personally, and I'm not going to give names, as to why you have so much junk on the internet about statins, vaccinations, et cetera. And the answer was, some of the same people who get Americans to hate each other from a political point of view get Americans to hate each other regarding health measures. Some of the same bots are actually inside of public health messaging. So if you're a local health department director or you're a school nurse, empathetically, sympathetically, culturally appropriate, but you got to speak the truth, because there are people out there who are speaking ill of us, bad news, wrong information on purpose, and it's seeded into our communities to the point now where speaking the truth is somehow some magical, mystical event.
Couldn't agree more.
So before we move on this, Keith, I want to ask you, how did you feel when you read Howard's piece? How much analogy did you find with the situation in Louisiana, even though the populations are so different?
Just a little bit, not too much. I think, you know, hesitancy and distrust and the feeling of independence, that's good. But at some point, and I really believe the reason the Black community is embracing vaccination and it's gone from the 30s to over 50% uptake now, is because we don't want to die. I mean, my people, the Ferdinands, have been down here in New Orleans longer than I know. And at some point, the survival kicks in where you say, you know, I don't necessarily trust the government. I don't know nothing about these vaccines, but my cousin died last week. My worker died 2 weeks ago. New Orleans, as I told you, was one of the first hotspots. I know people who died. I was out there on Mardi Gras. I shook hands and danced in the street with people who later died. And once it became clear, based on the phase three evidence, based on the uptake that was being seen in the general population, I became a vaccine ambassador. And I spoke directly. I went on Black radio. I went to Zoom meetings with ministers. I talked to regular folks about the ability to stay out of the hospital and not die from COVID-19. So I'm not sure what's going on in the Midwest. God bless you. But my people didn't want to die. They're starting to uptake vaccines.
All right. Yeah. And so let's see this, how we should craft the message to the people who are hesitant about taking the vaccine. Because as Julie says, there is all this misinformation and disinformation, and it's very powerful, but it's done by a small minority of people. And the discussion I've had with different experts, in particular in communication, social media, we're going to publish them in the May issue, is that we should try to be positive. We should not focus on trying to fight the misinformation, but we should be positive and show the advantages of the vaccine, et cetera, and try to convince the people with a positive message. So what is your opinion, all of you, about how we should proceed?
Well, I guess maybe I'll start on that. You know, as a general rule, at least in my experience as a local and state health director, and of course, you know, Dr. Gerberding has got the big national and international experience that none of us else have. But, you know, you've just got to start by knowing your audience. And the way that you're going to approach, you know, Dr. Ferdinand's population is different than I'm going to talk to folks in Montana or in Kansas. And so, you know, yes, I would agree. You have to have a positive message that acknowledges the concerns of that population, but there is no one size fits all. And to think that there is just going to be a fallacy. And so you know your population, you understand their concerns, and then you can start to address in a more concrete and positive way the need for vaccines. And the other thing that I'll jump on what Julie said is when COVID actually hits, that changes minds. I will tell you, my girlfriend is from the small town in Florida called Live Oak, which was one of those anti-vaccine places up in the panhandle you'd ever seen. Until, as in South Dakota, two of the local nursing homes got COVID, and it decimated the nursing homes. And then folks couldn't line up fast enough to get their vaccine. So, you know, we don't wish ill upon anyone, but there's absolutely no question that we can fine-tune messages and we can do everything we can that the communication experts tell us, but there is absolutely nothing that changes minds like having something happen in your backyard.
You know, I think one of the things that I was concerned about and just watching the messaging at all levels over the last many months is that we rely on facts and figures, data and statistics, and the left brain approach. But this is really foundationally a right brain issue. It's about how people feel. It's how they're managing their fear and their uncertainty, their anxiety, and their confusion in a lot of spaces. And we have created an enormous amount of unnecessary confusion because of the large gaps in one leader versus another leader's statements and approach. So I would add to what you just said, Howard, in the sense that in addition to knowing the audience, is to lead with empathy, not with facts and figures, to acknowledge this is hard for everyone. And we're all a little bit worried. By now, most people know someone who's been affected or died. And it's really hard to know how to balance all of the different forces that are facing a family or an individual. And so to really start by appreciating the dilemma that people are facing and that these are hard decisions and there is a lot at stake. And, you know, then we can be experts and say, but as a physician or as your doctor or whatever, these are the things that I hope you will think about and consider. And, you know, I will work very hard to help you find a vaccine or whatever it is, so that it's not trying to make a logical argument. It's really going where they are and appealing to the emotions that are really underneath a lot of the resistance that I think people are experiencing.
I agree. You have to have empathy in your communication. You have to accept the fact that people have questions because they should have questions. You're putting a foreign substance into your body. And in that process, I patiently will await people asking those questions and give them the best answer I can. I have a funny little vignette. I was on Black Talk Radio, which I guess would be the same as talk radio everywhere. It can get really harsh. I mean, the callers will call you in and accuse you of being a foreign agent trying to kill the Black community. So this guy's wearing me out, and I'm trying to be empathetic, and I'm sympathetic, and I'm culturally appropriate. I'm talking the lingo, and he doesn't want to listen. You know, this, you know, excuse me for saying it like this, but I'm going to tell you how it gets on talk radio. The white man's trying to kill us. Oh, man, come on. It's not that simple. I saw this guy about 2 weeks ago. He'd gotten his vaccination.
Well done.
So you see, that's fantastic. You're all on the same ground. You're all agreeing, you know, empathy, knowing your population, knowing how to talk that. So, Akib just gave us an example of how it is to be empathetic. But there is another issue that has been really major in how the pandemic has hit our population is the inequity. I mean, some population has been hit more than other, and apparently some populations, you know, have access to the vaccine more than others. So what can we do to make sure that the vaccination campaign is as equitable as possible? What are your suggestions?
Let me tell you really quickly what we're doing in Louisiana, because Louisiana was one of the first places where it was identified the higher increase in hospitalization and death in the African-American community. Our governor formed a COVID-19 health equity task force, and I'm on that commission. And they specifically looked at the hot areas. They used the vulnerability index, which I know CDC has developed for other reasons, but they use it as places where they should make sure that there were community centers, even local churches, drive-throughs, where you would have vaccines available. So we are specifically trying to target in Louisiana those areas with high vulnerability index.
Got it. All right. Anyone else wants to chime in on that?
Oh, just to add that I really think that this is another reason why the faster we can get doses made, the better. So that this allocation phase where we have to be judicious in who gets what dose when and where, we could have predicted it would be imperfect. And I think this idea of basing allocation on vulnerability, not just medical risk, but the sort of social determinants of that risk factoring into the equation is really an innovation. And I hope it's one that is durable once we're past this phase, because I can see that could be important in a lot of other significant public health issues that we face.
Absolutely, absolutely. So we have a question, and it's related to the one we were just discussing. What are some examples and ways one can introduce a racial equity focused approach to innovating business models and programs within? So I'm not sure I entirely understand the question, but maybe you do.
Yeah, I'm not really sure what the question is in terms of business models. I told you what's happening in Louisiana, and Dr. Gerbening actually teased out a little bit more. I used the jargon vulnerability index. You look at the map, zip code analyses in terms of income, family households, multi-generational households, percentage of minorities, levels of education, and they pop out at you. They're dark green versus other areas that are light green. And then you can take those particular areas and look for places where you can make sure that the vaccine is available and being delivered. Of course, the Johnson & Johnson makes it a little easier, one shot. You don't need the deep freeze. But by doing that, you overcome what happened early on in the vaccination process, where you had to go online, First of all, you have to know how to navigate the doggone internet. And many times the vaccination sites were in large academic hospitals or in big places who had the freezer capabilities. So if you were tucked away in some neighborhoods and you didn't have transportation or you didn't even know how to get online and get an appointment, it wasn't being done. So there was an uptake, which was predominantly more educated, more white, even in areas like New Orleans, which is 60% Black. People just weren't getting it. But we kind of flipped the script when we used the vulnerability index, using local pharmacies, even doctor's office, community centers, and even some churches now have vaccination sites. So that's the way you do that. You look at the data. And I often say, when you talk about racial inequality, I really don't care about bad tweets and Facebook posts. It's about the structure where people live, work, and play that we need to change. That's the problem. It's not just calling people out of their name and a rebel flag. You know, if somebody came past me with a rebel flag, I don't care. But if somebody will help educate and feed children, make sure that people have access to insurance, identifiable source of primary care, referral to specialists, you look in electronic health records and you see gaps in terms of using evidence-based medicine, I care a lot about that. But too much now, I think we're dealing with window dressing, calling people names and what's the right terminology for this group versus that group. You know, it's a 2021 world, but that's not my world. My world is dealing with structural inequalities.
Absolutely. Building bridges. So if anyone wants to chime in on this, I can otherwise read the other question. We have a new one, which is also closely related to what we are talking about. Montana and Vermont are giving vaccination priority to people of color who are at the higher risk of COVID-19 infection and severe disease. Should other states follow suit?
Well, since you mentioned Montana, I guess everybody as best you can in this Brady Bunch Squares is looking at me. Should they prioritize people of color? Yes, assuming that, and I think it's probably true, assuming that is one of the higher populations at risk and one of the highest populations that has decreased access to vaccines. If that's true, as I suspect it is in most places, then yeah, absolutely, they should. I sort of try and look at these things from the long game. There's absolutely no question about social determinants of health impacting care, no question about it. And if in fact you've got a limited supply of vaccine, that needs to go to the most vulnerable population. And I would speculate that in most places, that's going to be a population of color of lower socioeconomic status, lower educational status, less access to transportation, less access to healthcare. So if that's how your demographics play out, absolutely you should. And it doesn't matter if you're Vermont, Montana, or New Orleans, you play your demographics.
Absolutely.
Thanks for mentioning Montana.
All right. And so one of the issues that we had, and I really would like to have your feedback on this, is that in order to implement the vaccination campaigns, we need to have the workforce. As you know, there's been a terrible crisis in the public health workforce. At some point last year, we were expecting about 30% of the workforce leave the field, you know, for a different reason, either because they would get to pension or they were young people who found other attractive jobs. So what do you think should be the priority now to actually create a public health workforce which can implement those vaccination campaigns, those communication campaigns, and build a more equitable system for the future?
You know, I would like to respond to that because it's a chronic problem that's just been illuminated and exacerbated in the context of this pandemic. But you know, all of the money that's being appropriated to help us solve the pandemic is not the solution because it's one-time money. And you can't hire people on a supplemental, you can hire them temporarily, but you can't build a sustained workforce and evolve them and train them and support their professional development, et cetera. So when we really sit down to get serious about the after action and the reformations that need to follow this pandemic, that has to be at the very top of our list, because that's the front line. And this situation in community after community has revealed that there's really no there there. So when you need surge, you have no background or no succession to pull from. People are overstressed, and I know they're working 24/7. It's really a whole entire workforce that's trying to run a marathon at sprint speed, and it's worn out.
Unfortunately, before the pandemic, there were actually cuts to the CDC budget. And as a cardiologist and hypertension specialist, at one time, most state health departments had hypertension departments where they actually did a lot of outreach and screening and education. Those were cut out. And now we're seeing, if you look at Paul Muntner's last report, in which he looked at blood pressure control rates, they're going down. It's not getting better, it's getting worse. So if we build that public health infrastructure for chronic diseases, it will be available to have transition over to infectious diseases when they arise. And just be aware of the fact that any monies that are given right now is probably too late for this particular pandemic, and hopefully will be available for the next.
You know, I guess my answer to your question about, you know, the workforce and the infrastructure is to take a step backwards first, because I'm not sure we know what public health is going to look like after all this. I think it's going to be radically different, and it's going to be different in every community because every community has had a different response to COVID. And I think once we figure out what public health looks like, then we can figure out what the workforce is going to look like. And then we can figure out, you know, who we need, what specialties we need, what expertise we need. But it may be that what we value now in public health, and I don't know if this is going to be true or not, but it may be that the things we value now in public health, at least at a local and state level, may be radically different than what we may value 6 months or a year from now. And we may actually be turning over a workforce in totally different ways. You know, maybe less people involved in process, and maybe less people involved in programs, more people involved in surveillance, more people involved in the media, more people involved in communication. And so I think this is an opportunity to expand the public health workforce once we figure out what public health is going to look like. And I don't know what it's going to look like. I just know it's going to be different.
That's a great point. Anyone wants to chime in? How is going to public health look like? I mean, that's our, you know, central preoccupation at the journal. We've been trying to publish on this and offer some options. But what do you think? How do you see public health being transformed after that crisis?
Well, I would like to believe that we will still always build whatever it is that we're going to need on a foundation of science, and that we need the state of the art science and technologies, the tools that are modern and lean into the future of health protection and health creation, rather than relying on methodologies and approaches that are really not taking advantage of the data revolution and the technologies that we ought to be applying routinely for surveillance or vital statistics reporting. It's not just about data modernization. There's a whole new world of environmental health. We've got the science of climate change. We need to understand the One Health emergence. We need to be able to do much more to predict and preempt these kinds of emergences rather than simply putting all of our efforts into the science of countermeasures and reactions. So we have to really think carefully about what science do we need and assure that we are investing there. Not all that science is going to come from the CDC, obviously, although they definitely need some investments there. But this is an opportunity to also think about how to involve our schools of public health and our academic medical centers, et cetera, in building the public health science of the future. Really, in the same way that NIH funds biomedical research, we need to put a great deal of investment in building out the science and the scientists who will also help shore up our ability to operate and implement or to execute our public health strategies. So I want to believe that this is our moment. And that's why, again, your building bridges concept is just, it's just so right on, but the window will not stay open very long. So we need to get our act together and have very clear expectations and a very clear process of contributing to that conversation, striking while the iron is hot, because it won't be long and we'll move on to the next crisis, and whatever has been the past of this pandemic will be left in the dust. That's our cycle, you know, complacency to crisis, complacency to crisis. And this is our moment, so we better go for it.
Absolutely. I hope as many people as possible listen to you and see your two fists, because
you said we have to be activists. Well, let's be activists. Let's activate.
But I can't resist to build on that. And because I have three doctors here, you know, one of the major issue with the old system is that it has mostly invested in clinical care and treatment and very little in prevention and public health. So should we change that? Do we all agree that this would be one of the priority of the new system? More prevention and less healthcare.
Yeah, clearly more prevention. I've had a long career, and at one time I got the exciting position where I could do interventional cardiology and stand there with a catheter in my hand and blood spurting all over the place. I really remember it coming across my forehead one day. Am I doing any good? I mean, am I really helping people? And the answer is that more is done through changing the sodium load in school lunches and dealing with early identification of chronic disease risk factors, hypertension, cholesterol, diabetes, helping people get access to medications, making sure that there's universal health insurance, affordable process by which they can get medications, and having medical homes where if someone has a problem or a concern, they can go and seek care. That's really more important than what we cardiologists usually get our big kick out of, doing device and interventions, which, you know, for the individual patient, of course, is very important, but the burden of disease is going to be through prevention.
I wanted to chip in just for a second, and thank you for reminding me of my ER days when things would splash on me too. So that was a great memory. But I want to go back to, you know, what we were talking about what public health is going to look like. And I absolutely echo everything Dr. Fernand and Dr. Gerberding said. But I do think public health has got to be a lot more relational and a lot more media savvy. When I was a county health department director in Florida, one of the mottos was out of sight service. So nobody knew what you did. You didn't have any instant credibility because nobody knew you were there. You were just sitting in the background. I think our public health leaders in the future, whatever public health looks like, have got to be incredibly media savvy. They've got to be out in front of issues, activists, as both of my colleagues have mentioned, but out in front of issues, recognized by the community, recognize their political leaders, building those relationships so they're not sidelined and they're not in the background when these sorts of things happen. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean the political leaders and the media will do what they want, but at least you've got an elevated platform to get that message out and you're not sidelined. And I think in so many communities, public health has been quietly doing their job such that when something happens, nobody knows they're there and they're not empowered and they're not out in front the way we should be. So I really think we may see a change towards public health, less doing programs, less doing process, more relational with the community, more relational with our leaders, and much more media and social media savvy.
Absolutely. And this, you know, is consistent with what all of you said before about the necessity of empathy and understanding the population we're working with. I have another question here from the public, and it's on a very key aspect of our response to the pandemic, an aspect on which we pretty much failed in my own perspective. And I think we did even worse than we did in 1918. And it's the question of surveillance and knowing, you know, where the pandemic is going, what's the proportion of the population that has been infected, being able to track the herd immunity curve. I mean, this has been absent for a year or so. And so I have a question here says, kind of a fun one from the chat: in the American context, how do we balance respect for patient health information and upholding HIPAA while moving forward with opening up the country and using tools such as those proposed, such as the proposed vaccine passport?
Well, I think HIPAA is used as an excuse for not having available information across our country. And you really can de-identify patient information and find out where there are hotspots, where there's been an early uptake in one of the variants, B117, B135, 1P2, P1. And if you had that material available, then you could focus more of your efforts in making sure that the mitigation efforts are a little stronger, and even doing heavier vaccination in certain areas where you have hot spots. We talked about surveillance, again, going back to my cardiovascular roots. We talked about that for many years in patients with hypertension, high cholesterol, not just doing BRFIS, but actually measuring and looking at electronic health records and centralizing that information to know where we need to make more efforts to control risk factors. One of the problems is that the business people who've gotten their dirty hands, I shouldn't say dirty, who've gotten their energetic hands into medicine don't really want to have communication across systems. You know, if you work for one academic center or one private center, you don't want your data to be available to anyone. You want to kind of keep it under wraps so that you can market and sell your data, and also you can hide some of your mistakes and gaps in terms of equity and care. So we need to have surveillance, not just for infectious disease, but for chronic diseases also.
But isn't the question, you know, talking about something that we were, you know, alluding to before, you know, the how do we talk to people? How do we make ourselves understood? So there are ethical issues with surveillance systems. So how do we convince people that we need to get this information in order to know what's going on and having a dashboard? I think that's what I'm getting out of the public question.
You know, one of the things that I like to start with when I'm thinking about how to improve surveillance is, what are the questions that we most need answers to? And we could start with vital statistics and death rates, because that's pretty foundational in terms of monitoring the impact of a pandemic. And without going into it, I think we've seen significant improvements in our vital statistics registration for births over the last few years due to a lot of hard work on the part of local and state people with CDC and the National Center for Health Statistics. But the death registries are still problematic. The data are accurate ultimately, but not timely because of the intense effort necessary to improve the reliability of the information that comes in and the multiple layers of adjudication that go into that. And the fact that the system basically has not received any increase in funding for a long period of time. That's just a fundamental piece of surveillance. We're not talking about genomic surveillance or, you know, real-time prevalence data. But it also takes me back to the last pandemic that we were all involved in, the AIDS pandemic. And, you know, in the beginning of that pandemic, we didn't have testing either. But we did a lot of other things to try to understand the epidemiology. And we did, CDC and the public health system did a number of nested studies, you know, a family of studies, so that you may not be able to do everything in the entire population, but you can get really critical information by focusing in specific areas of transmission and really going deep into who, what, when, where, why, and how is this happening. And I think that real-time exploration of the deeper epidemiology has been hard to do because we're spread so thin, just trying to first take care of sick people, second, get testing and reporting underway. There just isn't the bandwidth that I think we had even back at the beginning of the AIDS epidemic to think about the broader agenda and the resources necessary to accomplish that. So I don't mean to sound defensive, but I just feel like the glass is half full in some sense, but on the other hand, we sure wish we knew a lot more about the disease transmission, and especially now in the context of the variants. But also, you know, why do some people get so sick and other people don't? I mean, just the very basic information we don't have yet.
Well, I agree 100%.
You've been muted. Keith, you have to unmute yourself.
You don't want me to, because my cell phone is going off.
Okay. I thought you were still talking. But let me just say something. You know, in 1918, it's more than 100 years ago, the U.S. Public Health Service had a house-to-house, you know, random sampling survey of 140,000 people in the United States to know what was the prevalence of the infection. We haven't had anything randomly selected and sampled over the last year. And this seems to be something very basic for a surveillance system, to be able to know what's really going on and not be victim of selection process, or who can access test, or misclassification, and other issue. So I think we have a real problem here. And we also need, as the person who asked the question proposed, be able to convince the population that this is safe and useful. All right, so there is another question, and it's about a population we haven't discussed about yet. It's indigenous population. So what can we do? What about increasing access of health for indigenous population? Anyone has an opinion on that?
Well, again, let me give you the Louisiana experience. Along with African Americans, we have some national tribes here, the Houma tribe, and there's actually been efforts to focus in those particular areas, and they're in our committees to make sure that they have trusted messengers who speak to them so that they can have the uptake of the vaccine. I was just thinking about what's going on in Europe with the third or second or fourth wave. I don't know how many waves they're in there, but if we don't have surveillance, and I'm not saying that we're gonna have everything perfect, but if we don't know who's getting sick and where they are, we're gonna get blindsided again. But to answer your question on indigenous nations, yes, that's very important.
Thank you. Howard, I mean, in terms of indigenous population in Montana and Julie, since you're from there, I mean, the Dakotas, Montana, I mean.
Yeah, so, you know, like many big companies, Merck has employee business resource groups that are characterized by special interests or special backgrounds. And we do have a special interest group focus of people who are either Indigenous Americans or concerned about the health status of Indigenous Americans. And I'm one of their sponsors. And so we really did sit down and try to understand what is the base case here, what is going on around that we could find, and it's not really compiled or presented in an easy to recover place. But it's kind of a confounding of the special culture and beliefs, which is not uniform, obviously, across many nations. But in addition, many of these individuals live in rural areas, so they have two hard to reach dimensions to their demographics. And one of the, I don't want to single out a particular state, but my understanding was that New Mexico, for example, really did put a very high priority on working with one of the nations there to try to achieve 100% vaccine coverage, et cetera. But also the telehealth and Project Echo, some of the systems that have been developed to really reach the medical community and the patient community in these difficult to reach areas has also been called into action, at the very least, to help spread information. But I'm sure whatever we're doing, it's not enough. And it's another area where I think we're going to have to take a harsh look at where did we succeed and how bad was our failure.
Absolutely. So let me ask you, I mean, that's probably is going to be the final point of our discussion, but it's a very important one, at least also for the journal. I would like you to know, what do you think are the strengths of our current system? What are the strengths that will allow us to succeed and to get out of the crisis and be stronger at the end of it? I would really like to have everybody's opinion on that.
Well, I'll take it first. I think the strength of public health right now is twofold. One is that although we've talked about how maybe we don't have the people right now for public health of the future, the people we do have are generally incredibly committed to what they do. They work long hours for poor pay. They could all make more money in the private sector. And yet they stick with what they do because they believe in. I mean, that is a resource that you can't put a price on, and that's a great resource to build on. The other thing I would say, and this comes a little bit from my experience as a state health director, is that public health is actually a fairly easy sell to policymakers. You can disagree about how to get to a goal, but generally nobody disagrees with the goal, right? Everybody can say, yep, let's go vaccinate people. And you can argue about how to do it. Or you can say, yep, more people should stop smoking. And you can argue about how to do that. But from a policy standpoint, public health itself is a pretty easy sell. And I think that's one of those advantages, that we should take advantage of that and get people in the room knowing that 50% of the job is done, because everybody agrees where we want to go, and knowing that the nuts and bolts is really what the problem is.
Thank you, Howard.
I think one of our strengths is that the public health leaders have recognized gaps in our systems where you have not only racial ethnic minorities, but the essential workers, regardless of race, ethnicity, and have looked at the areas like here in Louisiana, where you have higher levels of vulnerability and targeted vaccination programs to address those needs. So there are good things going on. And certainly when I said that I didn't feel too optimistic, I meant right now. I think in the long run, we'll make out, but we're still gonna have a lot of death and disability before we get to the promised land.
Yeah, I have to always say the workforce. I agree with Howard on that point. It's that strong sense of purpose. But beyond that, I think there's also a very special, almost philosophy of public health. It's an integrated, interdisciplinary effort. And you can't lie from the harsh realities that you see in front of you every day, where we're strong and where we fail, and the lives that are adversely affected by the things that we can't get done or don't have the resources to do. And at the same time, when we have a success, you know, it is something that the whole community can celebrate and benefit from. So it is the best bargain in health, and we need to really make that visible.
That's great. And I may add that what I think is the strength of the system is what actually this panel represents. I mean, what you represent for me, you are smart, competent people, great experience in public health, fascinating passion by public health. You have beautiful personalities, friendly personalities. I would like to go and have dinner with all of you, or a barbecue, according to who we're talking about. And you are focused on what should be done to be effective. I mean, you come from very different, again, background and probably political beliefs, but you were on the common ground. You built bridges during this panel. And I think that's our strength. Thank you very much for being on this panel. And I wish next time we'll meet in person.
Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Fun.
Thank you.
Okay. Take care, everyone.